Hello there, people. We are going to look at Stack Overflow 2022 Developer Survey. We have to put some caveats in there. And yes, I have my beauty enhancement lights on, so you really can see how pale, you can see how pale I really am. Also, I just like that it gives a better mood. It's in the apartment, so I'm more relaxed, don't rage. Anyway, go into that send mode. We have to put in some caveats with this. This is primarily developers. So you don't see many system architects, network architects, server architects, server administrators and stuff like this. This is code monkeys. This is primarily done with a coder or developer audience, or for a developer coding and developer audience. So everything that these numbers and things that go into this survey is saying has to do with that, mostly. So what you see here don't represent the server market, it don't represent the desktop market, it don't represent the YouTube hobbyists like you and I are, if you have a channel like me, you know, we are the Linux, Windows, YouTube hobbyist audience. We are not represented in here. It's for people that either work full-time developing part-time or have some sort of development effort in their life. They are doing some sort of development and are using Stack Overflow. This could end up being a long one, so I will have timestamp for some of the things to be going over here. So here, this is education. It's actually a really, really interesting one. Most developers, 87%, have a post-second education, having some college or more. So if you look here, all responders, how many of them have what is their educational level here? So we can see something else, other doctor's degree, PhD, EDE, etc. But not that many. I would suspect more. Master's degree is kind of up there. Bachelor's degree is kind of up there. Some college, secondary school, American high school, you know, German reschooling, or what the fuck, Warsaw? Gymnasium, you get what they hear. And you can then go in here, see of people that are professional developers or people that are learning to code. So we see a lot of younger people that are learning to code, you know, that, or people that don't have a higher education. Why do we see like secondary school people is this high compared to professional developers? It's probably because they are going to want to have a developing future. Learning to code by aids. Oh, here. Learning to code, how they are getting it. Hackathons, coding bootcamp, friends or family, colleague, on-the-job training, online courses, notification, book, physical media, school, university, college, online resources. This is actually not that surprising to me. And here we go by aids. So under 18 years old, not surprising. 18 to 24, online resources, not surprising. 24 to 34. Or 25 to 34. Again, not surprising. 35 to 44. Not surprising. Again, 45 to 54. Not surprising. You know, it's not surprising that the older they get, they are more reliant on older methods. Because when they were like our age, it was the way to do it was books, physical media. You know, when you if you were in your 60s plus and stuff like that. So that's why you see this go up here with even in my age group, I'm in this age group up here right now, book and physical media. I'm actually one of those that do it up here online. But this is not uncommon because when you went to school like I did, we didn't have YouTube and stuff like that. So it was books or other people teaching you this stuff. So it's a good picture, I think. Online resources, how to learn to code. So what are they using here? Well, technical documentation, Stack Overflow, blogs, how-to videos. I thought they would be a little bit higher, to be honest. Written tutorial, video-based online courses, online books, online forums, written-based, coding, interactive tutorials. This is all of the hype everyone wants. So these two here, online challenges and interactive tutorials, everyone say that's the way to go, and nobody really does it. Online courses platform, Udemy is actually quite up there. Code Academy also. These are both systems I have used before. So that's interesting. Experience, years coding, you know, 15 to 19 years, they are starting to go really, really, really down. Most people have like 5 to 9 years of coding. And here's years coding professionally. Again, it kind of, you know, say this, give the same picture. Years of professional coding experience by developer type. So again, designer, you can read this, scientist, DevOps specialist, students, of course, they don't have that many years of experience. Blockchain. Yeah, developer roles, developer types. What are the most heard of roles or count of roles? All responders. So developer full stack is what people apparently primarily are doing. That's the developer type. Continues to access the majority of all responders. Yeah, so this is people that are on Stack Overflow. This is primarily, you know, mobile developers, developer desktop, enterprise application, front-end, back-end, full-stack developers. You don't see many scientists. You don't see many security professionals. This here should tell you that if you want security advice, Stack Overflow may not be the right place to go because there's not many security professionals in there. Geography here, top 10 countries, this again, not surprising. Where is Denmark? You see here, we are like under 1%. And only 547 people were actually part of this survey from Denmark. Let's scroll down. Demographics, age. Yeah, my age group, the age group before me, my age group, and the age group after me are the ones that are, the most of them, of all responses in here. Again, it makes sense. So if we go into professional developers here, it makes sense. Ah, we're starting to get a little bit more of the younger crowd here. Learn to code, of course. People are young when they learn to code to some extent. So we have here programming, scripting, and markup languages. Again, I don't think this is a big surprise to anyone that Python is really high up there. SQL, HTML, CSS, and JavaScript. TypeScript and JavaScript. Bash Shell, for your Linux aficionados out there, is quite well or high up there. If you go into professional developers, it goes down a little bit. And then we have C#, Java, and all these things. We have C++, C, PowerShell, Go, Rust is really low down there. What is like some of the, Crystal, SAA, Julia, Cobalt, Fortran, Lua, Swift, Dart. I'm interesting to see how this is going in like 5 or 6 years. Learning to code, it's kind of mirroring each other. Again, Bash Shell, not that high up there. Databases, if you're interested into this. Again, I don't think this is a PostgreSQL actually goes up in professionals learning to code. Mongo, I never heard about this one. Microsoft SQL Server, okay. Cloud platforms, again, this don't. Well, I can kind of see why a lot of people that learn to code want to use the Google Cloud because it's really, really, really affordable. You can actually do a lot of things for free in there that you can't do in other areas. Web framework and technologies. Node.js. And again, there will be a link to this down below so you can go and read all this by yourself. I will only go deep into the subjects that I find interesting. Flask, what else do we have here? Node.js, React.js. Yeah, the Angular is actually quite up there. ASP.NET Core. So this is more like, I think this is more like a Microsoft thing. And the same here. What about learning to code? It changed a little bit. Other frameworks and libraries. .NET, who use .NET the most? Windows people. What is the most used operating system? Windows. Kind of makes sense, again, with professional. NumPy. Learning to code. NumPy. Pandas. .NET. So this, again, it makes sense. It makes sense. Qt is quite up there. Where's Qt on the professionals? Not that high. Electron is actually not bad either. Where is it under learning to code? Electron here. Yeah, other tools, npm, Docker, Yarn, Homebrew, Microsoft, Apple thing, Medusky, Unreal Engine, Flow, Unity 3D. Docker is really popular, like massively popular. Homebrew is really popular under macOS. It's basically so you can run open source software. So a lot of the software that you run under Linux, you can run on macOS via Homebrew. It's actually really, really interesting. Integrate development environment. Virtual Studio Code and Virtual Studio. Again, Vim, Emac and all of these things, just like for all of the respondents, Virtual Studio Code, Virtual Studio, IntelliJ, Notepad++. I know a lot of people laugh at this one, but Notepad++ is amazing for just going in and doing like a one-line edit or a file edit and stuff like that, where you don't need a full-blown IDE or development suite or stuff like that. Professional developers, again, Vim is actually quite up there. Android Studio, Sublime Text and PyCharm, Xcode. What about learning to code? Now PyCharm is getting up there, but again, we still see Virtual Studio Code and Studio. Asynchronous tools, I can't fucking speak. And people learning to code when it comes to, okay. So, workflow, Stack Overflow for Teams, Microsoft Planner, Professional Developers, Notion. I think, is this like note-taking apps? I think it is. Notion is actually really, really good. Trello, yeah, great. Synchronous tools, Zoom, Microsoft Teams, Slack, and Google Chat. Again, not a surprise here, especially not with Zoom and Microsoft Teams. Slack for professionals is actually really, really, really popular. What about Learn to Code? Well, now Zoom and Slack, they change operating system. How many of them use Windows? Professional use and personal use. So there are a lot of people that use Windows personally, but they probably code under, let's say, Linux or Mac OS or Windows Subsystem for Linux or BSD. And the professional use, it's not that high again. It's high, but it's higher than anyone else, but it's not massively higher than anyone else. Linux base for professional use and personal use. And if you look at these numbers here, what this tells me is that most people that use Linux professionally also use it personally. Well, if you compare to this one up here, means that a lot of people use Windows personally, but maybe not professionally. So they are like, okay, Windows is great on the desktop or as a home system, but not as good as a development station. Where down here, they are like, well, I work with Linux, so therefore I also use it at home. Or I have a Linux partition at home for work, and I use it more and more for my day-to-day things because I like it and it's already there and I'm already in it and stuff like that. It's not that surprising. What is surprising is down here that macOS, there's actually more people using macOS only as a professional tool versus a personal choice. So people prefer Linux as a personal system and as a development system over macOS. Again, we are talking developers, not desktop users, not administrators, not your accountants, not your lawyers, not your schools, only developers. You have to remember this, we are talking developers. And Windows Subsystem for Linux is kind of new, more and more people are getting over to it. And I think over the years we will see this shrink and this go up. I honestly believe that. Top paying technologies is probably something that you will be interested in. So let's just hold it here so we can see like the top, what is it, like 20 or 15 or 25, something like that. Polling, scripting and markup languages. Culture, Erlang, F#, Ruby, Elixir, Scale, Perl, Go, Rust, Groovy, where is Python? Is it even in here? JavaScripting, hasty, oh no, it's here. So if you're a Python developer, you actually get more as an assembly developer than a Python developer on average. Go is high up there. Rust is high up there. Groovy? Object-C is high up there. Let's look at databases. Let's look at platforms. Web frameworks. Other frameworks and libraries. Apache Spark. Again, Apache is really, really highly used. Other tools. Puppet, integrated development environment, Emacs, it's actually right up there, NeoVim, Vim, interesting. Vision control, again, Git, how is this, this is surprising. People that are learning to code don't use vision control. I will say the same here, I don't do it either, but I'm also just a hobbyist. I'm not learning to code, I'm just doing it for fun and in my spare time. And integrating with the vision control or version control, sorry, not vision, version control. Command line, code editor. Yeah. No surprise there. Version control platforms. Yeah, you bits buckets. I actually looked into that a little bit. Azure repos, custom build solutions, employment status. This is interesting. Employed full-time, student full-time, independent creator, freelancer, self-employed. A lot of people, they like to do, they want to be self-employed and freelancer. And more want to do that, but they are not that successful with it. They are many, many videos on YouTube about the freelancer, independent construction, self-employed aspect of coding and how most people do it as a side gig. And not employed, but looking for work. You know, I prefer not to say retired. And if you go over here, yeah, it's not surprising. It's not surprising. But this here, again, it's a little bit of a pipe dream. A lot of people, they go in, they learn to code, and then they want to be a freelancer and stuff like that, and most people don't survive. They can't survive as an independent contractor or self-employed or freelancer. It's like the minority. Work environment. This is interesting. because if you took, like, I don't have it up here, but if you look at this before 2020, so let's say 2017 and 18, these things here would probably be higher than this one up here. But because, you know, of the little human malware that we have running around, it has kind of been switched around. Most people, most developers are working from home. Why? Because they can and they make sense. Salary could be interesting. Engineering manager, engineering site, reliability, security professional. If you can become a security professional, you have a potential high earning job, but you also have a really stressful one. And if things goes tits up, they could potentially more easily fire you. You know, engineer data, DevOps specialist, project management, or manager scientist. Again, it makes sense. You know, if there's not a lot of people doing it, you get paid more. Or if it's a harder job, there's not a lot of people doing it and you get paid more. It kind of makes sense. Researching new tools and technologies. So what do people do when they want to research new tools and technologies? Makes sense. Ask a developer I know work with. Again, makes sense. Visit developer communities like Stack Overflow. Makes sense. Read ratings or reviews. I didn't know that was that popular, to be honest. Research companies that advertise on site. I visit research companies that have emailed me. Again, these two up here, it kind of makes sense. I'm sure most of us have tried a new piece of software and stuff like that as a free try to actually gauge if you want to pay it or buy it. Coding outside of work, this is really, really interesting. A lot of them do it as a hobby. And then the next one is contributing to open source projects, and the next one is freelance contract work. School or academic, bootstrapping a business, and I don't code outside of work. This here, yeah, I'm not surprising, because coding for an open source project give you purpose, you know. Most people that code, they like to code. That's why they're coders. They need to code. It's their outlet. It's their happy place. So it makes sense that they want to, you know, contribute to an open source project or, you know, do it as a hobby. Freelance contracting work. Now you have to deal with, you know, customers and customer support and angry customers and finances and all that fucking shit. Contributing to an open source project, you just write some code, send it out, and that's it. You go check the wife or the husband. That's it. Daily time spent searching for answers and solutions. This is an interesting one. Less than 15 minutes, 15 to 30 minutes, so up to an hour. Again, I'm not surprised. And it's kind of mirroring anything for people manager, independent contractor, and all responders. This is my philosophy, okay? If I employed people, and they don't have to be coding, we had a problem to solve. We need something to be fixed. They don't know it, or they have limited knowledge about it. I'd rather have they spend extra time researching and learning it so they can fix it, or spending extra time finding someone that can help them or do it for us. Because if you just spend 10 minutes just watching one video and then you start to do your Python coding and think you know everything about Python, you will make so much fucking mistakes that it will take probably 10 times the time fixing those mistakes than if you spend an hour actually learning what you need to learn. I hope I make sense here. If you want to read all of this into the minute detail and blah, 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 you can go nuts. But remember, this survey is only done with developers in mind. If you're not a developer, this is not meant for you. It can be interesting for people like you and me to watch and see what the development world is doing, if you have an interest in the development world. But this is not meant to represent you and me. It's meant to represent developers. No one else. See you all later. Bye-bye.